morning. Please stand for our call to worship. It's page 76, O Come, Emmanuel.
You can be seated. Do a little housekeeping here first. Pastor found these bifocal glasses up on the communion table yesterday. They're boys. Okay, I don't think he'll need them. Okay. Good morning. It's good to see everybody in the house of the Lord today as we celebrate the third Sunday of Advent. Joy. And I want to welcome everybody here today. If you're visiting for the first time, I ask that you just take your order of service, your bulletin there. On the inside cover is a QR code. If you're comfortable with the QR thing, just scan that and send, and so we can have a record of your attendance here today. Also, if you have a prayer request or a need, you can also scan that, and the staff will be praying for you if it is a prayer request. Also, if you're not comfortable with that, out in the foyer, there's some cards that you can fill out, and you can just give to the pastor on your way out. So it's a good day to be in the house of the Lord. The sun's shining after such a gloomy day yesterday, and so we're excited that you are here. and being a part of this service, this third Sunday of Advent joy. And I ask that you just take your worship guide and turn there, and we'll read responsively about the Advent candle joy. And I will read the light color. You read the ones in the bold, please. Rejoice in the Lord always.
I will say it again. Rejoice.
Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near.
We rejoice in the hope of Christ coming. Let us worship God.
Thank you.
Our next hymn is page 118, What Child Is This?
Join with me as we pray. Father God, we come to you on this third Sunday of Advent as we continue preparing our hearts and our minds and our spirits to be receptive to and to celebrate the coming of your Son, Jesus Christ. Father, we're grateful for the gift of this day. We're grateful for the opportunity that has been given to us to gather in your house with your people, and to offer to you our worship as a God who is great and a God who is good. Father, as we prepare to receive this offering, I pray that you would bless not only the gift, but the one who gives, that it might be used to further your kingdom in this community and beyond. A prayer we offer in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, our Savior, and our friend. Amen.
Thank you. First Noel, the angels did say, was to certain poor shepherds in fields there they lay, in fields where they lay keeping their sheep on a cold winter's night that was so deep. Noel, 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 born is the King of Israel. And by the light of that same star, three wise men came from country far to seek for a king. Was their intent, and to follow the star wherever it went. Noel, 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 born is the King of Israel. Then let us all with one accord sing praises to our heavenly Lord that hath made heaven and earth of naught, and with his blood mankind has bought. Noel, 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 born is the King of Israel. Noel, 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 born is the King of Israel.
Mary, did you know your baby boy would one day walk on water? Mary, did you know your baby boy would save our sons and daughters? Did you know that your baby boy has come to make you new? This child that you deliver will soon deliver you. Mary, did you know your baby boy would give sight to the blind man? Mary, did you know your baby boy would calm the storm with his hand? Did you know that your baby boy has walked where angels trod? And when you kiss your little baby, you've kissed the face of God. Oh, Mary, did you know? Mary, did you know? The blind will see, the deaf will hear, and the dead will live again. The lame will leap, the dumb will speak, and praises of the Lamb. Oh Mary, did you know your baby boy is Lord of all creation? Mary, did you know your baby boy will one day rule the nations? Did you know that your baby boy was heaven's perfect lamb? And the sleeping child you're holding is the great
song that over the years I have come to appreciate more and more. And I think part of the reason for that is I began to wonder. Somebody said, well, we know from the Gospels that Mary knew that her son was going to be special. In fact, she was instructed to name him
Jesus,
or he would save his people from their sins. And I thought, well, that's true. But here's what I've wondered. And that is, did she know everything that would entail getting to that point? Did she know that it might be a life of only 33 years? My guess is she probably couldn't imagine what that was going to mean for her, for her son, for the world. 2 weeks ago, we began our journey through Advent, and we lit the candle of hope. And we talked about the hope of the prophets that they had for a coming Messiah. We talked about our continued need for hope in a world that can be extremely cynical, even as it is a world that can be quite frightening. Last Sunday, we lit the candle of peace. And we noted that God desires that we live in peace with ourselves and that we live in peace with one another. So on this third Sunday of Advent, we light the candle of joy. And you might notice, if they, you know, one of the questions I get from time to time is, why the pink candle? You know, the liturgical colors for Advent are purple and blue, and yet we have this one pink candle. Why? Well, it seems when the church fathers first began observing Advent, it was a season of the Christian walk and the Christian journey that was very somber. In that, we were supposed to do penance during the Advent season. We were supposed to seek repentance for our sins and remember and recall all that Jesus did and why Jesus came and what he did and that sort of thing. But they began to say, you know what, it's a little bit dreary. You know, it's a little bit worrisome. It's a kind of a, it's a Debbie Downer, if you will, to have 4 weeks of this. Let's just take, and on the third Sunday, let's do a different candle and let's talk about joy. Okay. Now, I don't know about you, but when I think of the word joy, I tend to go back to my childhood. And I remember this little song that we used to sing. And maybe some of you in here have sung that song as well. One of the verses went something like this. I've got that joy, joy, joy down in my heart. To which someone would then say, where? And everybody would yell, down in my heart. Where? Down in my heart. I've got that joy, joy, joy down in my heart to stay. Okay? Most of you in here remember that song. For those of you who do not remember it, Donna will be teaching it at some point, and you can all gather around and join with her. But on a serious note, I always tend to think of that song as we prepare for this third Sunday of Advent, when it is indeed the Sunday we light the candle of joy. In Luke's gospel, we are told that following the birth of Jesus, an angel appeared to the group of shepherds in a nearby field and announced to those shepherds, "Do not be afraid, I bring you good news of great what? Joy that will be for all the people. For today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord." The Bible is a book that simply pulsates with joy. Over 500 times in the Scriptures, we are invited, now let me rephrase, we are commanded to rejoice. For example, the psalmist tells us, quote, "This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it." Again, in Psalm 66, verse 1, again, "Shout with joy to God all the earth." Paul in Philippians chapter 4, verse 4, that was a part of our responsive reading to the lighting of this candle, tells us, "Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice." Let me simply share a couple of things about joy very quickly. First thing I would tell you this morning is this. There is a difference between joy and happiness. You see, joy is much bigger than happiness. Because happiness is often seen as being dependent upon external circumstances, while joy is not. There is a big difference between being a person that's happy and being a person that's joyful. Happiness often depends on what's happening to us and where we are. Joy, on the other hand, is much deeper than that. It's much larger than that. The second thing I would share quickly is that while a person may indeed find happiness, it's often short-lived. How many of you can recall a time in which, you know, I think about this when with our kids, when our kids were growing up. In fact, I think about it when I was growing up. Because I can remember every year about this time. You know, what you do? You make a list out of things you want. And I can remember making a list out and telling mom and dad or Santa, "I just got to have this. If I can just get this, I'll be the happiest person in the world." Only to receive that gift on Christmas morning And within a week, it was somewhere in the house. I didn't know where it was. And I saw the same with my kids. Just had to have it until they got it. And then after a while, it wasn't that important. The point I'm saying is that while a person may find happiness, it's often short-lived. Or worse yet, it's empty in providing any kind of ongoing, continuous fulfillment in life. We can find happiness in all kinds of things, but you take those things away and suddenly we're no longer happy. Joy, again, is much bigger than that. So the question becomes, what exactly is joy? Well, we can go to a dictionary and get a definition. The only problem with getting a definition from a dictionary is that it doesn't tell us where, nor does it tell us how you and I can obtain joy. Okay? Our text this morning speaks to the subject of joy. If you have your Bibles or New Testaments, I invite you to turn to John's Gospel, chapter 15. And there are three verses that I want us to read, words spoken by none other than Jesus himself. When he says in John chapter 15, beginning in verse 9, "As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Now remain in my love. If you keep my commands, you will remain in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commands and remain in his love. I have told you this so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete." The setting of our text in John chapter 15 is shortly before Jesus is to be crucified. Okay? And after teaching his disciples many things, he said, "I have said these things to you so that my joy may be in you and your joy may be complete." What's Jesus saying? Essentially, Jesus is saying that he came to fill his followers with what? Joy. The problem with human beings, Jesus is saying, is not that we are way too joyful as human beings. Jesus is not saying we're way too joyful and God really wants us to be serious. Okay? That's not what Jesus is saying. Rather, what Jesus is saying is not that we're way too joyful and God wants us to be serious, but rather our problem is that you and I are deprived of joy and God wants us to dive deeper into his joy. Listen, the joy we often see in innocent children is just a fraction that lives in the heart of God. I was reminded last week, Thursday, Friday, and Saturday, small mall. I was reminded of what I'm reminded of each year when we do that. And that is to simply observe children as they come into the building and begin with their parents filling out the Christmas list of individuals they need to buy for. And the reason I talk about that is because it's amazing to me how excited and how joyful they are, not because they are getting something for themselves, but because they are looking to purchase gifts for others. They're looking to make their life better. They're looking to do something that they think will bring happiness, yes, but also joy. And what I would submit to you is that those who receive the gifts from the children do not experience the same joy that the kids get as they purchase gifts to give to others. The joy that innocent children have so often is simply a fraction of the joy that lives in the heart of God. G.K. Chesterton put it this way, quote, "God has an infinite capacity for joy." So the question becomes, exactly where and how do you and I dive deeper into the joy of God? I think our text tells us two things today. First, joy is found in relationship with Jesus Christ. You see, at the heart of Jesus' message and mission on this earth was His desire to demonstrate how much He and how much God loves us. Notice the way Jesus puts it in verse 9. As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Coexist with doubt. He can coexist with ambiguity. Jesus can coexist with pain. Happiness begins in a relationship. You say, well, how in the world can that happen? How in the world can one find joy even when everything looks, feels, and tastes wrong? How does one find joy in the midst of doubt and ambiguity and pain? How can that be? It's because the joy we have, the joy you and I have, is a product of God's love. A love that knows no ends. A love that knows no boundaries. To find the kind of joy that the Bible talks about begins in the relationship we have with God through Jesus Christ. We don't earn it. It's there. You know. The second thing I would say from the text is this. I thought the only way I could remain in Jesus' love was to obey His commandments. In other words, I thought that somehow I had to earn His love. Problem is, that becomes a very simple way of petty is as petty does, you know. You obey the commands, then He loves you. You disobey the commands, He doesn't love you. Okay? That's not what John 15 says. John 15 tells us that the love of God for us is a given. Okay? I've asked the question before, how exactly do you get God to like you or to love you? And people are, well, they're a little nervous about how to answer that, but let me just fix that question and say, okay, if we're uncomfortable trying to answer that question, how does we get God not to like us or love us? And boy, people got answers all over the place, you know. The fact of the matter is, God's love for each and every one of us is a given. Jesus said so in John 3:16. For God so loved the world. Okay? In other words, God's love for you and I is there before we do anything good or bad. And even more importantly, God's love will always be there. Jesus is not saying that our obedience wins His love. What He is saying is that our obedience deepens our sense of His love for us. And it can deepen the joy that we find within each of ourselves. Folks, if we could ever get that truth through to people, that God loves us regardless, it could, quite honestly, change everything. Because you see, in our society, we think happiness is something we pursue. That joy is something we pursue through money, through fame, through pleasure, regardless, other things, whatever it might be. But often what we see is that those who pursue happiness with reckless abandon, doing whatever brings them pleasure, whatever makes them happy, are often those who wind up in despair. Have you ever asked yourself why it is that there are so many people who appear to have anything and everything, who, if you get serious relationship or a serious discussion with them, will finally admit that they're not really joyful? Life doesn't mean a lot to them. It's amazing to me. Because here's the thing. You and I will not find joy by pursuing joy. If you really want to find joy, we find joy by pursuing God in Jesus Christ. We find our joy by abiding in Christ. We find our joy by obeying Christ. We find joy by living as deeply in Christ as we possibly can. And that little song we sang when we were children about having that joy, joy, joy down in our heart to stay. The truth is that you and I will feel the most joyful when you and I know without a shadow of a doubt that we're doing what God wants us to be doing in any given moment. Because there's no greater joy than to be doing what it is God wants us to do at any given time. I want to close our time this morning with two quotes. First quote is from a gentleman by the name of Sam Shoemaker, who wrote the following. The surest mark of a Christian is not faith or even love, but joy. Now you think about that. The surest mark of a Christian is not our faith, it's not even our love, it's our joy. And then Lewis Smead wrote the following, quote, "You and I were created for joy, and if we miss it, we miss the reason for our existence." We talk about God is good all the time, and all the time God is good. Why? Because God wants you and I to live not only with hope and peace, He wants you and I to live with joy. And the kind of joy that God grants to each of us comes only through a relationship with Jesus Christ and by being obedient to the commands of Jesus Christ. So the question for this third Sunday of His Advent is this. How are you doing? How are you doing in living the Christian life? The psalmist tells us that those who sow with tears will reap songs of joy. The psalmist also tells us that weeping may remain for a night, but joy comes in the morning. Let me tell you something. Joy can come today. But it begins by having a relationship with Jesus Christ. We're in a season in which we celebrate his birth. And the reason he came was that we might have life, have it more abundant. That if we put our faith and our trust in him, we might not only have faith more abundant, but we might have faith everlasting as well. If you want to experience joy in life, it begins by having a relationship with him. And you may be here this morning saying, Terry, I don't have that relationship. I've never received Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior of my life. I've never put my trust and my faith in who he is and what he's done and what he desires to do. You want to give yourself a gift this Christmas? That would be a pretty good gift. You may be here this morning saying, you know what, this whole faith stuff is just kind of, I don't know. It's just kind of become tedious. It's become boring. I don't feel the joy that I once felt as a follower of Jesus Christ. Remember what I said? There's two things required. One is a relationship with Jesus Christ, and the second is obedience to the commands of Jesus Christ. Perhaps that's the reason for Advent. To simply reflect upon the life you're living and asking yourself, am I living with a hope for a better world? Am I living at peace with myself and with God and with others? And am I being obedient to the commands and the teachings of Jesus Christ that will allow my life to be filled with joy? If not, why not? Why not recommit your life to being a follower of Jesus Christ, doing the things you know that he wants you to do? I shared yesterday in a service we had here at the church that the person whose life we were celebrating and whose life we were remembering, their life was no different than the life of Paul. In fact, their life was really no different from your life and my life. And that the Apostle Paul once said, you know, those things that I know I ought to be doing, I'm not doing them. While at the same time, the things I know that I shouldn't be doing, those are the very things that I am doing. God loves you either way. But you're not going to find the joy that you desire if you're not seeking to be obedient to the teachings of Christ and the commands that God has given. Listen, Christmas season, my hope and my prayer is that each and every one of you can find the hope, the peace, and the joy that God desires for each of us to have. Father God, we come to you this morning. On this third Sunday of Advent, to deal with a subject that is often confused in our culture and in our society, by equating happiness with joy. Father, help us to understand that the two are not identical, but rather joy is that which comes when we are in a relationship with your Son, Jesus Christ, and when we're seeking to be obedient to his commands. Father, you know the hearts, the minds, and the spirits of every person in this room and even those who are listening online. And Father, my prayer would simply be that your spirit would have the freedom to speak to each and every person at the very point of need that they have in their life. Father, my prayer is that as we continue to move toward the celebration of Christmas, that Christ might be born yet again in the lives of each of us. Father, if there's anyone this morning that needs to make a decision, perhaps it's to become a follower of Christ. Perhaps it's to simply recommit their life to Christ. Perhaps it's to simply unite with this community of faith and membership, in service and ministry. Father, I just pray that at this time, they would be obedient to your calling upon their lives. Again, it's a prayer we offer in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, our Savior, and our friend. Amen. For those of you who are present here, I'm going to invite you to stand. David and the team are going to lead us in a song of response entitled Joy to the World, Unspeakable Joy. You stand, join with them as we sing to God.
Joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let earth receive her King. Let every heart prepare him room, and heaven and nature sing, and heaven and nature sing. Joy to the world, the Savior reigns. Let all their songs employ, while fields and floods, rocks, hills, and plains repeat the sounding joy. Repeat the sounding joy. Repeat, repeat the sounding joy. Joy, unspeakable joy, in overflowing well. No tongue can tell. Joy, unspeakable joy, it rises in my soul. It never lets me go. He rules the world with truth and grace, and makes the nations prove the glories of his righteousness and wonders of his love, and wonders of his love, and wonders, wonders of his love. Joy, unspeakable joy, an overflowing well, no tongue can tell. Joy, unspeakable joy, it rises in my soul, it never lets me go. Thank you.
I appreciate your coming and joining with us on this third Sunday of Advent. I do have a couple of three announcements I need to make very quickly. Number one, we are continuing to do peanut butter and jelly sandwich lunches for the boys' basketball team at Winnetonka High School, and Charles has kind of been overseeing this, and there is, in the parlor on one of the round tables out there, there is a sign-up sheet based upon the number of people he feels he needs, based upon the number of lunches we have to do. Some days we do 14 lunches. There are days we need to do 42 lunches. So if you'd be willing to look at that over and put your name down for a spot, that would help him have a better understanding of how many people he either needs, how many people he's going to have coming, and whether or not he needs to get on the phone and hire other people to come and to be a part of it. Second announcement I need to make is the Lottie Moon Christmas Post Office. If you've not checked to see if you have cards, would you check and see about whether or not you have cards that need to be picked up? I came in yesterday, and the A through C slot, you weren't getting another card in them. It was that packed. And my name doesn't end with A, B, or C, so I knew none of them were mine. But if your name ends with A, B, or C, you may want to check and make sure. The last thing I want to share is this coming Wednesday evening at 6 p.m., not 6:30 as normal events are, but at 6 p.m., we're going to be having the reading of a Christmas story down in Fellowship Hall. And prior to that and following that, there will be hot chocolate, coffee, I don't know what else, tea, I suppose, and there will be cookies. So you can come and just sit, visit, have a great time. We'll drink, you know, drink whatever beverage you have there that you like, and we'll go, hot, what? I'm not telling anybody to bring their own bottle. I mean, I know we're Baptist, but I also know we're Baptist, and so I'm not telling anybody to do that. But it's a good time. It's a good time. It's a time just to really sit around and visit and fellowship and that sort of thing. So I invite you to do that. Next Sunday, we will be celebrating the fourth Sunday of Advent and lighting the candle of love in our morning worship. And then we will be gathering again at 5 p.m. To light the Christ candle and to simply sing carols and to talk our way through the Christmas story. And so that's always a special time. And I invite you to come and be a part of that as well. Is there any other announcement that I'm missing? No? All right. JT, would you dismiss us, please, sir?